to be discussing near vertical incident skylight. We good on that?
Yep, you're good.
Okay. All right, so some of y'all have probably heard the term NVIS. Sometimes you hear it called NVIS. It's just basically the NVIS, near vertical incident skywave. So, well, military guys ought to recognize that one. Bottom line up front. NVIS serves a specific purpose. It's a propagation method that's intended to cover an area beyond ground wave, but closer than skip zone, within the first skip zone. So basically when y'all are talking and you're talking a long distance via skywave, there's a point in there where you can't talk. You're either talking to somebody local or you're talking to somebody far away and you don't get in between. When you're running NVIS, you have to have the proper antenna and antenna configuration needed in order to do that. And this, I have very, capitalized right there. Frequency used for best results is very critical. And I want you to remember that word, critical. It's going to come up later. Frequency usage can vary daily, hourly, or even by the minute. So it's something that you kind of got to stay on top of. So just a little history on the subject. NVIS was basically kind of discovered on accident. The German army, the Nazi army, actually is the first ones to use it and kind of discovered it. It was in the late 1930s when they were fighting the Russian army on the Eastern Front. They noticed that they had capabilities and they could talk to people that were very far away, or they could talk to units that were very close to them. But there was a problem with these intermediate units where they could not talk to them. They discovered that using lower frequencies, and this was pretty much kind of on accident, they were just trying to use frequencies that they could reach people. They noticed that if they lowered their frequency and had a low horizontal antenna, they could talk to those people in between. The United States Army had similar problems during World War II, specifically on D-Day. On D-Day, they had units that were just several miles from them. They had units that were several hundred miles from them. But a good portion of the forces on the invasion were in an intermediate area. So they were having problems talking to those. LOS is beyond line of sight. But they noticed that there was, once again, the skip zone between faraway stations and nearby ground wave stations. So, just like the military, we want to do intermediate communications. So uses for NVIS, regional nets. That would be like the Roadrunner net. We have the Panhandle Traffic and Emergency Net, several other nets that are mostly just kind of New Mexico, Texas, maybe into Arizona and Colorado. So kind of a regional net. This is done, NVIS is also very good for disaster and auxiliary communications within a state or a nearby state area. If you think about it, a lot of disasters, unless they're a whole, continental United States problem, they're usually located areas. So think of like hurricanes, earthquakes, stuff like that. So you would have areas that are probably, maybe the region of Southeast United States or just within a state. Intermountain area communications between valleys. Anybody ever try to talk between two valleys with a mountain in between? Doesn't work too well. NVIS can solve that problem. And militaries use NVIS communications between units in intermediate range. NVIS is very effective at QRP, which is low power, and field expedient antennas. So it's wonderful for disaster communications or even getting out and just playing radio on the weekend with a portable unit. One reason for that is because of the angles that we're using for our propagation. There's not a lot of, you don't have a lot of signal loss, even when there's a lot of, when you're using low power or low antennas. or field expedient in tennis. Do you have a question, Earl?
Yes, I do. What's a field expedient antenna? Is it like somebody's bed spring, or is it a wire antenna, or what is it?
A field expedient antenna is any antenna that basically you can carry by hand, carry easily, and set up very quickly. It doesn't take much to put the antenna up. The antenna, it's usually, say, a wire antenna that you can string out really quickly. You might not need a lot of supports. You're not going to have permanent infrastructure to set that antenna up. Is that good?
Good.
Okay. So let's kind of cover a little bit of propagation and some of the ways that we already use skywave propagation and ground wave so that we can kind of determine what our problem is and what we're filling in. Skywave propagation. Anything that's beyond line of sight or ground wave, and it requires the use of skywave propagation. That's where you're refracting your signal off the ionosphere, which we're still going to do with MVIS, but we're going to do it in a different way. Typical skywave communications use the F layer of the ionosphere. So here's our kind of a breakdown of our ionosphere. We're down here in the troposphere, hanging out, having fun, breathing. Once you get up higher, usually around 50 miles or so, you start getting into what's called the ionosphere. This is a charged region of the atmosphere, and it's broke into several different layers. We have the D region at the bottom, the E region, and the F1 and F2 regions, which actually combine back together at night. During the day, they actually split into two separate regions. So this is what you're using to refract your signals in order to get skywave communications. This is beyond line of sight. This is not what just antenna to antenna, I guess you could say. You're actually having to bounce your signal off and bring it back down to the ground. So most traditional skywave propagation aims for long distance DX contacts. We're all ham radio operators. You're always wanting to reach a country that's further away, somebody around the world. And that's typically the aim for people when they're trying to gather states. You want to talk to people around the, very far away, 1,000 miles away. You might be trying to talk to other countries several thousand miles away. And that's typically one of the things that is a common goal between most amateur radio operators, specifically on HF. So in order to do that, you have to have what's called a low takeoff angle to provide the most distance. So, I have a better slide for that. We'll get to that low angle here in just a moment. Although typical HF antennas aim for low takeoff angle, and I'll just explain that one real quick. So you got your antenna here. And most of the time, vertical antennas do work better for DX because you can get a lower angle of radiation, thank you, from a vertical antenna. You can still do it with a horizontal one, but if there's a few other things you have to do to get that angle of radiation out. So if you got your vertical antenna here, the low angle means it's just most of your energy is going down at a low angle. This would be a high angle of radiation, so you want to keep that down as low as you can, and we'll put all this together here in a moment. Ground wave. So this is kind of the, I guess I'll say the opposite of skywave. This is where your signals are propagating along the surface of the ground, allowing on lower frequency for the signal to extend somewhat beyond the horizon. And we'll get to that in just a moment. This is where your radiation coming out of your antenna is just going straight out. It has a certain amount of range to it. Local communications, say, around Clovis area, probably say within 20 to 50 miles, depending on the frequency, is what your ground wave is going to reach. The wave fronts continue to angle more and more towards the ground due to differences in propagation velocity between the ground and free space. Basically, simply put, RF travels slower through the ground versus the air. And that results in the wave height being dragged down. So here's kind of put all these together here. So here's our transmitter antenna. We have our ground wave coming out, our signal just coming out. As it's moving along the ground, there's different propagation velocities between the RF up here and along the ground. What happens is that starts, they almost start kind of angling down, which decreases your height above ground. And you can typically sometimes get ground wave propagation beyond line of sight, nice thing about HF, versus VHF, because these will actually, instead of just going necessarily just at a straight line, straight out from the antenna, since they're dragging down, they'll actually go around the curve of the Earth slightly. So that gives you longer ground wave. I mean, think about it. Here, I'm sure most of y'all have listened to AM radio stations. And you can hear them 200, 300 miles away. They're very low frequency. Sometimes even further than that. Because their ground wave is actually curving over the curvature of the Earth. So here's kind of a comparison. I'll move over here. Here's kind of a comparison between sky wave and ground wave. As you can see, the ground wave comes out and it just kind of tapers down to, that's your absolute range. Sky wave, you're sending it up, it hits the ionosphere, and it comes down very far away. That's where the skip zone comes in. The spot between where your first sky wave jump is going and the end of your ground wave. In this configuration, you're not talking to anybody here. Nobody can hear you, you can't hear them. So let's talk a little bit more about the skip zone. Most of everybody's heard about skip zone, right? You've heard about skip zone? A lot of y'all? So like I said just a moment ago, it's too far away for ground wave or line of sight, but it's too close for traditional sky wave. Basically means I can talk to somebody across town, and I can talk to somebody 1,000 miles away, but nobody in between. Let's take a closer look at that again. Now, if you'll notice, if this antenna were coming up more, you'll notice this is nearly perpendicular to the antenna. That's a low angle of propagation, of radiation. So it's going way out there and hits the ionosphere. And it comes down way far away. The ground wave is pretty much going to be set. It's more dependent on frequency, how far your ground wave is going to go. But that's a low angle of radiation like I was talking before. So you can talk to people in this area via ground wave. You start getting over here, starts getting a little pretty weak signals and whatnot. And you can talk to somebody over here like they're sitting here. But once again, nobody in between. We want to get rid of that skip zone. So we're going to fill in the gap.
Can I ask another question?
Go ahead.
You said depending on frequency. So does that mean a higher frequency has a shorter ground wave?
A higher frequency doesn't tend to follow the curvature of the Earth as much as a lower frequency. And let me go back a second. So a higher frequency versus the lower frequency. A higher frequency doesn't follow the curve. So this is a very exaggerated, not to scale drawing. Let me put that out. So higher frequencies such as VHF, UHF, even say 10 meters, you're starting to get into the range where instead of your signal following the curvature of the Earth to a certain degree, it's mostly just going in a straight line. So you get to the point here, or even like right here, it's above where these people can receive. Because it isn't curving down with the curvature of the Earth. That's why VHF, UHF, they're such high frequencies, you don't really have ground wave. You literally have, if the antenna can see the antenna. There's a slight following of the curvature of the Earth at VHF and UHF, but it's pretty negligible. You pretty much, if the antennas can't see each other, and I don't mean visibly, I mean if they're not, you can't draw a straight line between the two of them, they're probably not going to talk to each other. That's why we love to put VHF repeaters and UHF repeaters on top of mountains, on top of tires, on top of high buildings. Because You'll climb up on top of a tall building. You can see a long way. It's literally line of sight. So NVIS, or near vertical incident sky wave, is used to fill in the gap between the ground wave and the long distance sky wave. That's typically between 35 to 500 miles. Most HF frequencies, you can get around 35 miles with ground wave. It's going to vary a little bit. Conditions do vary, you know, power output, orientation of antennas, stuff like that. But you can get around 30 to 35 miles on ground wave. 500 miles, most sky wave that you do is not going to reach much in from that 500 mile mark. And that's just because when it goes up, it comes down, you're just not getting that angle tight enough to close in on that point. So we want to fill in that gap. Now, NVIS, and we're talking SkyWave before, and you know, talking about skip zone, NVIS is still SkyWave. I mean, it's literally in the name, near vertical instant SkyWave. But it's got a catch. And NVIS, I know everybody who's read study manuals, talked to everybody, it goes against everything you've been taught for SkyWave. You've been taught, or everybody's always talked about, you want distance. You want to talk long, far ways away. Build your antennas so that you got the lowest angle of radiation. So you got low takeoff angle. Use the higher frequencies so that you can really get out there and, you know, touch somebody that's 2,000 miles away. That's what everybody's goal is. You read it in the manuals. They very rarely touch on wanting to talk to anybody that's, you know, two state or, you know, in the next state. It's always kind of the goal, it seems like, to be trying to talk to somebody that's 2,000 miles away. And it's fun. It's DXing. Anybody who's done worked all states, worked all countries, this is what they've designed their antenna systems for. So high takeoff angles result in RF energy being refracted nearly down. So now we're going against the grain here. We don't want the low takeoff angle. We want to have a high takeoff angle. And what that does, see, as you raise the takeoff angle of your antenna, you want more of your RF going up. And see how that changes the angle when it refracts back down? It's like this. Instead of like that, you have less skip zone in here. So we want to get our angle of radiation nearly as high as we can, probably between about 75 to 85 degrees. High takeoff angle and the right antenna. NVIS does not work very well with vertical antennas. It's very hard to get your antenna to radiate off the tip on a vertical antenna. Some might go up, but you're not sending most of your RF up. They don't have a high enough takeoff angle, and they really can't be forced to focus their radiation upwards very well. Pretty sure if you took a long enough antenna, make it a long wire, which tend to try and send RF off the ends, you could probably do it, but I'm not sure that anybody's going to be building a 1,500 foot tall antenna anytime soon. Very often,
challenge accepted.
And that is not saying it's impossible.
Donations accepted too. For wire.
Donations accepted too.
But even then, you've got to design that antenna very specially in order to get it to want to radiate off the end of the antenna. So it's pretty impractical, especially for amateur radio. Horizontal dipole slopers and inverted V's antennas are best for NVIS, because they need to be able to focus as much of the radiation up as possible. And if you just think about it very simply, it's very hard if an antenna's like this to get it to shoot that way, lay it on its side. Most antennas, I'm gonna put that as most antennas, work towards a perpendicular of the radiator. So you have your dipole when you're normally going off to the sides. Well, it's also sending a little bit up. They're sending a little bit down. But antennas work best broadside to themselves. So, High takeoff angle means going a cloud warmer. I don't know how much that term is used anymore, but it used to be a pretty common term that when somebody didn't build their dipole right, they didn't have it, you know, high enough, they were just warming the clouds because they were sending all their RF straight up. Well, oh my gosh, the humanity burned me at the stake, people. Have I not learned anything about building an antenna for amateur radio? I don't want to warm the clouds. That's what I've been told for years and years and years. Well, for NDIS, you want a cloud warmer. And like I said, you've been taught and preached that you want to make your antenna system go as far out as possible and not be just wasting your energy warming the clouds. So the perfect dipole radiation pattern for DX. Everybody's always told to have their dipole elevation pattern low for optimal DX. And this is not perfect, but this is probably about what you're going to probably get for a practical HF dipole that's horizontal. And if you'll notice our peaks here, we're sitting, probably 28 degrees, maybe 25 degrees on this main lobe right here. That's a fairly low radiation angle, especially for a dipole on a lower frequency. And this is what most people are aiming for, because that is sending that most of that RF out at an angle. And when it gets way over here, it hits the ionosphere and comes back down at a similar angle. And you have a long way away between those two antennas. We want this. You want that RF going nearly straight up, between 75 and 80 degrees to the horizon. So here is our radiation pattern for this dipole. And as you can see, most of the energy is going nearly straight up. The peaks on this are probably right around from here and up, right about in that area. That's where most of the RF is actually going. There's quite a bit still down here, but you've got a lot more going straight up compared to that, where nearly none of your RF energy is going straight up. So how to make your antenna a cloud warmer? You got to get that antenna low, or at least relative to frequency. Most of y'all have probably been told that if you're going to take an antenna in a horizontal dipole, what's the best height to put it? Anybody remember? I know somebody just took a general class test.
I said a quarter wave.
Quarter wave? But most of y'all have probably heard the best ideal height is half wave above ground. And that's going to get you a pattern that's going to look like that, or maybe even a little bit lower, at a half wave above ground. But we want to get them lower. So a half wave height. Pretty sure, if you look at this, this is going to be our main NDIS frequencies. You got to be low. And we'll get to that here in just a moment. Half wave heights for lower frequency amateur bands. So 75 or 80 meters, 123 feet above ground. 60 meters, 88 feet above ground. 40 meters. 66 feet above ground. Y'all are probably starting to look at something here and going, I don't have my 75 meter wire at 123 feet in the air. No, you don't. So you might be already onto something. If you run an HF horizontal antenna, you most likely already have an antenna that can do NVIS to a certain point. NVIS antennas should be between 0.1 or 1/10 and 1/4 wavelength above the ground. So if we look at heights of antennas for amateur bands that are typically usable for near vertical instant skywave, and that 1/10 to 1/4 wavelength above ground, 75 or 80 meters, 25 to 62 feet above the ground. I'm betting most of y'all probably already have, you have a 75 or 80 meter wire, it probably falls within that range. Might even be a little bit lower. 60 meters, 18 to 44 feet above the ground. You're probably still within that range. 40 meters, 13 to 30 meters, 13 to 33 feet above the ground. How many of y'all have an antennas that are probably much higher than 33 feet right now? And that's on 40 meters. And you can go lower than that for NDIS. There has been tests that have been done. There's actually a few on YouTube. Some guys have went out and done some NDIS testing. And they've had their antennas as low as 5 feet off the ground on 40 meters. And still done wonderful work with NDIS. So you got to get the antennas low. They're also very easy for portability. For one, you're looking low. You don't got to go find a 70-foot tree and try to figure out how to get an antenna up into it. This high is fine. So you're going to be easier finding supports for an antenna like that. It's a wire antenna. Whether it be a dipole, you can even use end-fed. It's something you can roll up and you can just about carry in your pocket. So they're very good for portable antennas. This would be like the Yaesu YA30. They work good for NDIS when you get them low. They're also very good at being multi-band. And amateur designs, and I didn't bring it, I was wanting to, but I realized there's not quite as much room in here as I had originally thought, is the U.S. Army AS-2259-GR field antenna. And I'll show you a picture of that one here in just a minute, at least the Army's drawing of it. Or you can use mobile whip antennas that are bent over. So this is the AS-2259-GR. A lot of people kind of call these a cone-style antenna. You can also call it that. It's a center mast. In the Army version, this is also a feed-wide. And it has four wires coming off of it. Two of them spread across from each other. In the AS-2259 version are about 44 feet apiece. And then the other two are right around 22 to 23 feet apart. It's a self-supporting antenna because it uses its radiators to help hold up the mast. I've actually built a version of this antenna that's been modified to work on 75 meters and 40 meters. It still has about 44 foot length for the 75 meters with loading coils on it. This height for the Army version is 15 feet, so it's still low. This is actually designed for one guy to set up in about 10 minutes, and that's if he has to untangle his wires. The mast on the AS-2259 actually pieces together, and it serves as the feed line as well. They just plug the radio in at the bottom, and they're good to go. So that's basically probably the most popular NDIS antenna that the United States Army is using. There's several other ones they use, but this one's man-packable. This thing packs into a pack about that big, about that big. Throw it on their shoulder, they can get to go. They can set it up in 10 minutes. They got their PRC 150, kind of getting rid of those, so maybe 160 now. Hook up to the bottom, they're on NDIS within about 5 minutes. Notice the military loves NDIS because you do get that constant coverage between zero and, say, 500 miles, depending on the frequency. So a lot of times you see the antenna tied down. And you can do this on your vehicle as well. You just have a long whip antenna, and you bend it down. It's just making it a horizontal antenna. This works. But if you really want to use a whip antenna on a vehicle, don't pull it over the vehicle. Actually, pull it towards the back, away from the vehicle, and tie it down. You're probably not going to be going down the road like that, or you might want to make sure you've got a flag on the back of it. But the vehicle does affect the antenna on that and detunes it some and makes it less effective. But that can be done. So we talked about antennas. Now you got to make sure you get the right frequency. And lower frequencies, but not too low. And this is why MBIS should really be named Goldilocks. In order to utilize the high takeoff angle for very few different refraction angles, you have to use the right frequencies for best results, but not too high, not too low, but just right. And there's kind of a little narrow area that you can kind of use it, but NVIS for maximum efficiency, you really have to be just right. So the frequency can't be too high. Well, everybody knows, and I'm just going to go to the extremes here, you can use HF for SkyWave, right? VHF, UHF doesn't work too well. And these are two extremes here. Why? Because HF, lower frequencies, up to, say, 30, 50 megahertz when we have the right conditions, can still be refracted by the ionosphere. You get much higher than that, they just go into space. The frequency is too high to get enough refraction. As you can see in the comparison on frequencies here, 5 megahertz is being refracted more than the 20 megahertz, and the 100 megahertz isn't even getting a return trip from the ionosphere. So you can't go too high. You don't want to shoot your signal through the ionosphere. So, and basically that's what I was just going talking about as well. You don't want your signal going off into space. So you don't want to go too high. Well, most people, when they're looking at frequencies to use, they use what's called the MUF, maximum usable frequency. And that's what you typically are looking at on HF, is the maximum frequency that will still return from the ionosphere, which is great for SkyWave. But even that frequency is too high for MBIS. But you can't be too low. If you go too low, everybody remembers the darn D layer, right? Kind of gets in the way. What does the D layer do? It absorbs frequencies. That's where you get the minimum usable frequency. It's not talked about as much, but I'm sure all of y'all have heard about the minimum usable frequency. Once you get below the minimum usable frequency, that signal, for all intents and purposes, has been absorbed by the D layer. The only thing you're going to do with that is ground wave. So if it's absorbed in the D layer, it can't make it to the F layer, or the F2 layer, which is really what you're looking for, in order to get reflected back. And just remember, just because it made it through the D layer once, doesn't mean it's making it back down through it. And this is kind of what I was talking about here. You got to get through the D layer to get a signal up. This signal right here, it's absorbed. It never made it to the E layer, never made it to the F layer. This is where our refraction comes from. You can get a little bit in the E layer on some frequencies when it's charged to a certain point, but most of our propagation comes from the F layer. So your frequency needs to be higher than the maximum frequency being absorbed by the D layer. Now, I'm sure some of y'all have probably seen these maps on solar weather. There's a number of websites out there. Spaceweather.com is an excellent one. And like I said here, this is a bad day for radio, by the way. We got a lot of rain. That was in 2006, I believe. There was actually a X-ray flare that had caused a really strong D-layer absorption that day.
I believe there was one day before yesterday.
2 days.
Yes, 2 days ago.
It shut off South America's shortwave totally for a while.
Right. And I believe yesterday there was one as well. But it was more over and towards Africa, if I remember correctly. Now, this is only on the daytime side of the planet. I mean, this is daylight in New Mexico. In fact, it looks like it's probably about noon here. From the looks of things. That is a very bad day. Most of the time, typical days, you're going to see some blues, maybe into this light blue, turquoise type color, is what your normal D-layer absorption map is going to look like. that's a bad day. That's going to have, I mean, if you look at this, highest frequency affected by the D layer or 1 dB of absorption, it's all the way up to 35 megahertz. We're getting 1 dB absorption. So these frequencies down here don't have a chance. So we want it just right. So we want it high enough that you're not going to get D layer absorption. It's going to make it through the D layer, and it's also high enough that it's not absorbed too much that even when it's reflected back down, it still has enough chance to get back down through the D layer. But we want the frequency that's low enough that it can still be refracted by the F layer and make it back down, not just shoot off into space. So, as far as NVIS, and I'm not sure how many of y'all have actually heard this term or seen this term, but the critical frequency for NVIS is also referred to as the FOF2. And I'll show you where you can find that here in a little bit. That is the frequency that's just below the highest frequency that will still be refracted at a vertical instant angle of incidence. When you shoot a radio signal up, it's harder to get it to want to refract back. The higher frequency, the higher the angle you have. If everybody remembers back in high school studying about refraction and reflection, especially refraction, the angle of incidence determined the angle that you would have refraction through the medium. And if you remember, you could take a glass of water and a pencil, and you could stick it in there and make it look like you got a broken pencil. But if you changed your angle to it or changed the angle in the pencil, you could nearly make it look like the pencil was still one piece. That's because you were changing the angle of incidence. When you shoot a radio signal nearly straight up, the frequency that will still be refracted is actually lower than what a frequency that you shoot at a lower angle would still be refracted, because it has more time to travel through the ionosphere to get refracted back down. When you get up this high, you have to lower your frequency, otherwise you're still going to just shoot off into space. So that's why I'm saying you can't be too high, otherwise it's going through. You go too low, it's never making it there. Oh wait, there's more. What is the critical frequency? Right now, I can't tell you. It's not a secret. It's an undiscovered scientific property. The reason is it's always changing. The FOF2, or the critical frequency, is influenced by the time of the day, i.e. the position of the sun, the time of the year, because as you get into winter, you have less direct sunlight to the northern hemisphere for us at this time of year. So it's going to change the amount of charging of and ionization of the F1 and F2 layers. And most importantly, the effects of the solar cycle. Right now, critical frequencies are higher than they've been for the past 5 to 6 years. As of even 2 years ago, critical frequencies were at the top end, about the 6 to low 7 megahertz range. We've had critical frequencies in the past 3 months that are reaching up to 8, 9, 10, and sometimes even 11 megahertz during the middle of the day. So the more ionization you get on the ionosphere, the more charging you get, the higher ionization densities you get, the higher frequency you can use and still have refraction. So that frequency is going up. But at the same time, minimum usable frequencies are going up too, because due to the increased solar activity, there is more D layer absorption going on. So as the critical frequency goes up, your minimum frequency goes up as well. So fortunately, it still leaves you a little window for NVIS quite effectively. So the FOF2 critical frequency goes up as the sun rises higher and drops back down in the evening, which makes sense. If we kind of go back and look at this right here, remember I was telling you this was probably about noon here? That's because most of the charging of the ionosphere comes from the sun during the daytime. And remember I've mentioned before, the F layers separate during the day because of the increased ionization, and they actually merge back into a single F layer at night because there's less charging. So in order to make sure that you don't have a signal that's just going to shoot off into space, as the ionosphere becomes less charged at night, you have to lower your frequency in order to keep from just shooting off into space. There's still some F layer at night that will handle refraction, but the maximum frequency you can use does go down. And of course, the angle of the sun changes. Typically critical frequency is higher during the summer months, just because we have more direct ionization in the hemisphere that you're in. Critical frequency also rises as solar cycle moves towards maximum. Like I said, we've had consistent critical frequencies as early as 9 o'clock in the morning, 8, 9 o'clock in the morning, right around in the 7 to 8 megahertz range. 2 years ago, you were lucky to get a critical frequency at 8 or 9 o'clock in the morning that was 3 megahertz. Go ahead, Ron.
Are you determining the critical frequency from your home, or is it on WWV, or what's the story here?
There are several sources, and I'm glad you bring that question up, because there's the answer. The easiest way to find the current critical frequency, or FOF2, and I want you to remember that FOF2, because you're going to need to know that when you're looking this up, is by looking at, there's several online sources. They show the current ionosound soundings from locations such as Boulder. It lists Austin, but it's actually in Dyess Air Force Base. There's a little separation there, but
big separation.
I don't know why they named it that way. It's actually at Dyess and Eglin Air Force Base in Florida. The U.S. Army Military Auxiliary Radio System Region 6 Solar Conditions is an excellent place to get this. They have lots of information. They have the ionograms. They have the sounding readings. They even have the D-layer map on there. They got a lot of solar information on that site. It's not going to give you all the information that you would get from like SolarHam. .com, stuff like that. The sunspot numbers I don't think are on there. But it's focusing more on critical frequency on that website because they do a lot of MBIS communications. There's also the WDV.com ionograms. They're very similar to the Mars ones. Both of these update every 15 minutes. And the reason for that is, like I said before, it's always changing. I've done NBIS on MarsNet that we've started a net out on one frequency, and 15 minutes later, we had to go up about a megahertz and a half to even have a net. It changed that fast. I'll give everybody a moment to write those down if they're wanting to. Yeah, this can be, it can change so quick, it's not even funny. You can have perfectly good MBIS communications covering from New Mexico, Texas, Arizona type area, talking to you like we're talking to you, right? You know, we're talking back and forth right now. Give it 15 minutes and nobody can hear anybody, and you're either moving up in frequency or you're moving down in frequency. So it's something that you want to keep an eye on. Now, there are ways to determine or estimate the critical frequency without looking at it on the internet. And that comes in handy if, well, for some reason you don't have the internet or the internet's unavailable. Consider disaster scenarios. You might not have internet access. Go to WWV. You got 2.5, 5, 10, 15, 20 megahertz that you can listen to. So go to 2.5. Can you hear it? Is it strong? Go to 5. Can you hear it? Is it strong? Go to 10 megahertz WWV. Compare those, and it's at least going to give you a block of frequencies that you can probably use. Now, with amateur radio, let's think of the bands that we have in there. We have the 75-80 meter band, we have the 60 meter band, and we have the 40 meter band contained within that 2.5 to 10 megahertz range that you can test using WWB. Well, if 10 megahertz is a lot stronger than 5, and you can't even hear it at 2.5, and this is really good for us here, because where is WWB? Fort Collins. It's within NVIS range of our location. So if you can hear WWB really good on 10 megahertz, can't hardly hear it at 5, and it's not even there at 2.5, 40 meters is probably going to be your best bet. If you go and you find out WWB is really strong at 5 megahertz, weaker at 10, can't even hear it at 2.5, 60 meters is probably your best bet for NVIS. If you go down and you can hear WWB really good at 2.5, not as good at 5, and maybe not even at all at 10, 75 meters is probably your best bet. That's a good way to guesstimate if you don't have access to the internet or maybe one of these sites to see what the FOF2 is. First off, let's kind of figure out how they determined these frequencies. They have what's called ionosonds. They have very powerful transmitters that shoot straight up at those locations. There's the ones I've already mentioned, Boulder, Eglin, Dyess Air Force Base. Those are probably our closest ones. There's also ones over in England. There's some in Asia. They're spread out across the globe. Several countries have these ionosondes. And they're probing the ionosphere for current conditions. First off, like I said, they shoot straight up. They want to see what the ionosphere is doing directly overhead. So they're looking for ionization densities. How dense is the ionization of the atmosphere, right, or the ionosphere right now? How high are the layers? Because they do change. They float around up and down. Like I said, the F2 and F1 layer, they actually come together into one layer at night. During the day, the F2 layer is a little bit higher. How much absorption and refractivity of the layers? They're all doing this by sending a signal straight up. And it's not just one frequency. They're actually sweeping a frequency. They start at a very low frequency and very quickly rise up through frequency all the way up to, I'm not really sure what their maximum frequency is, but I'm farther thinking it's probably 35 to 40 megahertz at least. They sweep the whole HF spectrum. And you've probably maybe even heard an ionosonde. You probably didn't recognize it because it just sounded like a zoop going by your frequency on sideband. That was likely an ionosonde. They're also determining the critical frequencies of the F and F2 layer and calculated lowest usable frequencies and maximum usable frequencies. Like I said, they use a sweep of frequencies to make soundings throughout the HF spectrum. This right here is an ionogram. And this is specifically showing, remember I wanted you to remember what FOF2 was, that's the critical frequency. That's because most of the time you're not going to find critical frequency written anywhere on here. They're going to call it the FOF2. Now, this right here is showing, this is the 21st of this year, of January of this year. The blue plot is the current today plot. So starting out at 0,100, and this is in UTC, the critical frequency, or FOF2, was right about 9 megahertz. You can see the blue. And you can see as the night, the morning was wearing on, this would be about 5 o'clock our time, the day before. Since this is midnight UTC. So as you can see, at 5 o'clock, and this is at Austin, you can see how as the sun started going down, the critical frequency started dropping. Until you get to right here, this is about, just after 4,
o'clock UTC, so this is about 10 o'clock at night. 9, 10 o'clock at night. You see how quickly it dropped off as the sun dropped, or set. The red is to give you a comparison. That's yesterday's readings. That's the plot from yesterday. So as you can see, it went down. That was the night. It sharply started coming up during the day. From the looks of things, it kind of went up and down a little bit here, so I would imagine there was probably, on the 23rd of January, there was probably some solar activity that day. That probably dropped it down and raised it up several times and ran through most of the day, and then we start getting, once again, towards the later part of the evening, it starts coming back down, because this is now midnight the next night. So this is a whole day put onto that ionogram. So this is one way you can look at it. So let's pretend that it's 10 o'clock at night. Oh, let's just go crazy here. Let's do 6 o'clock, or 6 o'clock in the morning. This is in UTC. Right now we're at -7. So 1300 UTC is our pretend time right now. So we're going to go to 1300. And normally this would have the blue one over there if we were at that time. But I'm going to use the red one just as an example. So 1300, I come up, and it's just above 4 megahertz, maybe 4.5 megahertz is what the FOF2 is. That's one way to look at it. I kind of prefer this. Mostly, like I said, nowhere on here does it say critical frequency. There's FOF2, 3.7. You can also use this right here. The FOF2 is actually this line right here. And this is kind of showing you what the ionosond is seeing when it sweeps the frequencies. As we go higher in frequency, you start seeing spots where it's getting reflection back down to it. So it's getting reflection at 2 megahertz, 3 megahertz. When you get to the point about right here, you don't see any more lines going higher in frequency, and that's because there's nothing coming back for the ionosond to receive. So where that cutoff is, which is right there, is right about 3.7. So this is the ones I like, mostly because you don't have to look at that mess. You can't. You don't really even have to look at this. You can literally read it right there. It gives you the year, the date, the time. This is at 0435 and 5 seconds on the 21st of January, 2023. That is in UTC, so that would be, 9:35 our time. 3.7 megahertz. Don't even got to think about it. You just go there, look it up. That is your critical frequency use for NVIS. So 3.7 is the critical frequency. You want to be just slightly below that. Remember, this is the frequency where things are starting to not come back. You go any higher, they're shooting off into space. So say 3.65 megahertz is probably going to be your optimum NVIS frequency. You can go a little bit lower than that, but you're going to start getting into D layer absorption, and you might, it'll work probably down lower another megahertz. You'd probably be able to look at your D layer absorption and find out what your lowest would be. But the lower you go, the more absorption you're going to have. So being right at or below the critical frequency is the frequency you want, which in this case falls within an amateur band. Problem is, if we look at this right here, at this point right, say, here, which is about 0200 UTC, it's at 8 megahertz. We don't have a band there. But you're probably still going to be able to do NVIS on 40 meters right here. It's below the critical frequency. You cannot do MDIS above the critical frequency. It'll work to some degree, but you start getting into needing lower angles and you're actually going more towards DX Skyway. But you can still go below it. And, you know, the lowest usable frequency, I'm not sure what it was that day, the D-layer absorption probably was probably somewhere down in between 4 and 5 megahertz. So it gives you a little window to use. You just kind of got to find which amateur band is going to fit within it. So I kind of went over that a little bit right here. Example shows FOF2 is 3.7 megahertz, so 75 meters, and actually be closer to the 80 meter spectrum of it, is the best amateur radio band for MDIF operations in this example. As most MDIS takes place generally between 2 and 10 megahertz, that's where you're going to find most of your MDIS. FOF2 could rise above 10 megahertz. Not very likely. I've literally seen it as high as 13 to nearly low 14, but that was a very rare day. So 80, 75, 60, and 40 meters are probably your best amateur bands for MDIS. Remember to use the highest frequency that's below FOF2 or the critical frequency available to you. That's what I was telling you a moment before. Your FOF2 might be 8.5 megahertz. We don't have a band at 8.5 megahertz. The next, the highest frequency you have available below that would be 40 meters. So it is just an example. If the critical frequency is at 4.7 megahertz, that means you can use the high end of the 75 meter band for MDIS. If critical frequency is about 6 megahertz, then your best bet is 60 meter band. FOF2 at 8.8, high 40 meter band. So you just kind of have to select from that. If the FOF2 got up to say 10 megahertz, 10.5 megahertz, you could do digital and CW on 30 meters and maybe still get some if it's above, you know, say 10.5 megahertz. But if you're doing voice, you're still probably going to be stuck down there at in the 40 meter band and see how that's working. But get your antennas low and try to get as close to the critical frequency as possible for NDIS. So just to summarize everything, NDIS fills the gap between ground wave and long distance sky wave, between 35 to 500 miles. It can go a little bit longer than that, but that's typically kind of the median range right there. It's dependent on frequency and near vertical takeoff angle of 75 to 80 degrees. Like I said, most of y'all probably already have antennas that are pretty close to the right height for NDIS. I don't know anybody that's got a 75-meter dipole 130 feet in the air. There are people out there that do, but most of us don't. I think most of us are probably in the 25 to 45-foot range, typically. So low horizontal antennas are crucial for NDIS. Like I mentioned, operate near the critical frequency for optimal NDIS propagation. The use of ionosondes makes determination of operating frequency much easier. You can go to those websites and look at the ionograms, and that's probably the easiest way to do it. Like I said, that one that I had right here, I mean, it's even right on top. You can't miss it. FOF2, there's the frequency. Questions?
How about ham sticks?
Ham sticks will work. The biggest obstacle that you may have with ham sticks is because they are so shortened, you really can't guarantee what their radiation pattern is going to be. I've used ham sticks for MDIS. They do work. But like I mentioned, once you start shortening an antenna to that degree, you're not really going to be sure what the radiation pattern is. But if you keep it low, keep it horizontal, it's likely it's probably shooting most of its RF straight up.
Well, I have a good example on the 75 5 meter nets in the evening. I hear a guy in Albuquerque, I hear a guy in Dalmar, I hear a guy in Amarillo, just great. But Jim and Tubin, I can barely hear. Oh, really? I figured it was because he was so too close.
See, that might be a perfect example right there. You said he's using a hamstick on top of his car. It's vertical. He does not have an NVIS antenna.
Yeah.
So you might have a horizontal antenna and you have an excellent NVIS antenna, but the guy on the other end has to have somewhat of the matching NVIS setup in order to make NVIS work.
There was something else that occurred to me, and that's ALE.
Yes.
Your ALE would probably just put you right in contact with whatever frequency works.
Right, and some of y'all might not be familiar with what Earl's talking about. ALE is automatic leak establishment. It's the military has hardware modems for it, but you can actually get software modems you can use on your computer and link to your radio. What it does is it takes control of your radio, and it sounds. It does soundings, basically. You can do soundings in order to create what's called a history that kind of gives the computer memory of what's typical at your station for propagation. But if I wanted to talk to Earl, and he's not just across town from me, I have a certain number of frequencies that I've already agreed with Earl that, okay, we're going to have a 75 meter, a 60 meter, a 40 meter, a 20 meter, and a 15 meter frequency, that I should be able to get a hold of him on one of those. My computer, I'm going to put those frequencies in it. I'm going to put my call sign in. I'm going to enter that I want to call him. His computer is scanning, controlling his radio and scanning those frequencies. About 1 to 2 channels per second. My radio, and so I say, I want to talk to Earl. Here's our ALE frequencies. I hit in, it takes control of my radio, goes to the lowest frequency, and sends out a call. Earl, can you hear me? You know, KD5XB, this is KC5VOX. Can you hear me? And it'll sit there for a moment. If it doesn't hear anything, it moves to the next highest frequency. It says, KD5XB, this is KC5VOX, can you hear me? Now he's heard that call. It goes, oh, stops the scan, puts his radio in the transmit and goes, hey, KC5VOX, this is KD5XB, I heard you. That tells both computers to stop and locks that communication. Now, you look at your screen and it says you're connected. I pick up the microphone and go, hey, Earl, how's it going today? Well, his radio has stopped on the exact same frequency, says connected to me. He picks up his microphone and goes, I'm doing just fine. We didn't know what frequency was going to work best to get between the two of us. So ALE will go through those frequencies automatically and try to find the best frequency within those predetermined frequencies that's going to work best for communications. And if that's a bad channel, you can let it start over. You can say, ignore that frequency, find me a better frequency. And it'll go through those predetermined ones and sound him each time until it finds a good match and the communications have been established. That's what ALE is. Yeah.
It gives a good example of Skyway versus Groundway. When I'm up at the lake, Alan, Doug, and Doug go stronger in the lake than 2 miles away than they are here in town.
Right. Because you're actually probably using NVIS. Because I'm.
Yeah.
Your antenna's, what, 20 feet off the ground?
Yeah, my antenna's all in.
Doug's is 20 feet off the ground?
But Doug's a little stronger because we're close together. But up at the light, they're all 9, 10, 20, 9, down here, 5, and 7. Same thing with two of us.
Right. Right.
That's
cool. Any other questions? Comments?
Well, comments, Gordon, thank you. You are,
You're welcome.
You, how many of you had a chance to look at any of his YouTube programs? Yeah, you know, if you haven't had a chance, please, you know, his style, as you see today, is really great, and comes across really well on YouTube. He's doing a tremendous job of educating us on a number of things. Gordon, we can't thank you enough. We appreciate your expertise.
Thank you.
He's got a lot of knowledge, and we all get to benefit from it. But I think we owe him a real round of applause.
Thank you.
He's a pretty fair technician.
Oh, he's a great technician.
He's just
got the sonar burns to prove it.